Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Herbine HR Consulting.
Hi, I'm Chris Holmes, and even though I'm the current chapter president for SHRM, the Berks chapter, I've been involved with our chapter for over 7 years now, and I really appreciate the opportunity to network with other HR professionals in the area. I also appreciate the speakers monthly at the events, at the meetings, where the topics are very diverse, very current, meaningful, and just help anybody in the HR profession grow, regardless of where they are at their level of their career. And I know that if you have anybody that spends at least, I'm going to say 50% of their day on HR-related issues, they're welcome to join us. Come check it out. You're welcome to come as a guest, and we'll be happy to have you, and hopefully you'll become a member with us. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Bob Orzechowski, and I'm the producer and host of Human Resource Management. I have guests tonight. Actually, the show runs Tuesday, September 12th, and has repeats, which we'll get to later. We're recording it tonight on 9/11, a very important date in American history. To my immediate left is Andrew Schreffler, Executive Vice President of Benefits for PK Benefits. And thank you for coming back again.
Thank you for having me.
With your expertise. And to my far left, Benjamin Lewis, and he's a compensation analyst for Chester County and is steeped in the total rewards concept with employees. So welcome back, Ben.
Thank you.
Ben's been here before as well. We're coming from the beautiful downtown Reading BCTV studios. And this is our 104th program, our 17th year. And we certainly want to thank our underwriter, Herbine HR Consulting, a full-service personnel human resources consulting firm. They're out in 2433 Morgantown Road, Suite 100. And their telephone number, and we'll show this later, is 610-779-3870. And a big shout out to Laurel Klein, who's their new CEO, and congratulations to Laurel. She certainly earned that one. The program tonight is focusing primarily on employee benefits. It's a wide area from legally required, which is about 15% of your payroll, up to 25-30%, depending on company size and other factors, sectors and all that. The disclaimer is that nothing's here meant to be legal advice, and the opinions of the panelists are their own and not necessarily those of their employees or of BCTV. The BCTV mission and the tagline, empowering people and engaging communities through media, they're a real gem in our community, and they're rather unique in their space here, and they certainly deserve everybody's support. If you get onto bctv.org, you can not only follow these programs and look at the archives, but there's topics for just about every interest, from dogs to guitar playing to social issues of all sorts, diversity, and there's basically something for everybody. This particular show, HR Management, replays Friday at 8 p.m., Saturdays at 1 p.m., and Wednesdays at 9 a.m., so no matter what shift you're working, you can find us out. But before we get into the topic of employee benefits, Society for Human Resource Management is a national organization with about 300,000 members. Actually, it's international. They're in a number of countries as well. And they have a real value to the HR professional or to those people who service the HR industry, such as benefits and pension consultants, health insurance brokers, and safety advisors, just a wide range of people who service the industry, certainly labor and employment attorneys, we can't leave them out. And it's a mark of professional achievement if you can achieve the certification through the society. It's a rather rigorous program, a lengthy examination you have to go through for that. But the Berks County chapter, we've been around for 50 years ourselves, and I was going to ask Andrew and Ben if they'd comment on the goals and missions, benefits of membership, and what we do and why they attend our meetings. Andrew, you first.
Sure. So obviously I can speak from the side of a consultant, insurance broker, however you define our role. But for me to have access to HR professionals, wide range of topics, you know, in the meetings, and really get other perspective from organizations of all size is really a huge benefit for me. You folks are on the front line. Our job is really to go out and try to find our groups the best possible price with the best carrier, you know, providing high quality benefits at affordable price, which is sometimes difficult to do. But again, getting that perspective from an array of members that you have, different organizations, different industries, is a huge benefit.
Okay, Ben, how about you? You're a member.
I am, and I would piggyback off that. Say you get access to this great network of people who you can ask, you know, informal questions to. You can pose a formal question to the group. We have varied offerings, both in person and virtual, you know, kind of meet the needs of your schedule. I find that we have interesting topics. We do a lunch and learn series as well as morning meetings. So again, kind of can meet anybody's schedule. And then even on top of that, we have the SHRM certification course, which allows you to get that material and take that test and get the certification. We have a study group usually in the fall, but also possibly in the spring.
We do have a number of, I forget how many committees we have now. Good heavens, it's grown. There must be a dozen. And Ben's heading up two of them for us, gratefully. And the meetings are always relevant for the people who are certified. They get their credits. You need 60 credits in 36 months, and you can basically get them all simply by being active.
Correct.
It's a good deal, and we're going to show at the bottom of the program just how you can reach our administrative director. You can get on the website for more information on membership, and check us out. And maybe if you don't need to have HR or personnel in your title, if you have a responsibility for people of any sort, and even if you're a small business person, you're covered by many of the same laws that the large organizations are. So it would behoove you to look into us. Employee benefits. I think when in researching the history of employee benefits, I think the first ones were a retirement plan for shoemakers in Philadelphia immediately after the Revolutionary War. And when you think about it, that's pretty advanced for its 1770s. And it's grown out obviously ever since. Andrew, I know you had some thoughts on the impact World War II had on wages and prices, and that gave rise to the fringe benefits.
Sure. Yeah, the 1942 Stabilization Act. So we were faced with all sorts of new acts and laws and rules just really in the last 16 years that I've been doing this. But all the way back to 1942, and I guess my understanding is it was really a product of not being able to raise employee wages to kind of steal them away from other employers during that difficult time. So they came up with the idea of fringe benefits, being able to use health insurance to entice employees to come and work. So pretty interesting to think way back when that they were doing that.
Well, I think when you look at that phenomena, then you would have thought that part of the door would swing both ways, that when the war was over and the Stabilization Act was moot, that there'd be clawbacks.
Once
that didn't
people
happen
get
so
something,
much, did
they
it?
Usually try to keep it, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm sure many employers would have preferred that. I know many, it's a real challenge, typically their second biggest line item behind salaries, you know, what they're paying for benefits. So it's always a tough balancing act.
How does an employer know if their benefits package is competitive, proper, legal, adequate, if people like it or not? Or what are some of the metrics that HR people should look at when they're trying to make these kind of decisions. And once you have a benefit, it's really very difficult to take it back or replace it with something else without some quantification.
Sure, sure. I mean, I think one of the big things that we talk about is benchmarking. So what are other employers doing? What are average deductibles and, you know, cost sharing for employees? What are they paying out of their paycheck? The challenge that we found is one of the big national surveys through the Kaiser Foundation. When you look at the footnotes, they're really polling large employers. So the statistically speaking, that may not be as pertinent for every group size. We try to do some more things regionally, locally, if possible, because again, I think you'll see things can vary state by state as far as what kind of averages are for insurance premiums, what employers and employees are contributing. But benchmarking is something that we do on a regular basis. And even within our population of 500 plus groups that we work with, trying to pull that data together and give groups locally ideas of what other employers are doing, without naming them obviously, but other employers as far as average cost sharing, deductibles, all of those things. So that's really the tool that we use on a regular mm-hmm. basis.
Well, I would think that the rich versus more modest benefits package is a function, it positively correlates with employer size.
Sure.
And oftentimes, certain industries, yeah. especially if they are more heavily unionized than not. It's interesting to see what all the fervor is up there in Detroit right now. Ben?
I think a good way to look at benefits and what you offer employees is it's a constant state of change, you know, based on your size, your location. Again, you know, states have certain laws that will impact you. A good way to do it, like you said, is benchmarking, but also looking at the Affordable Care Act and saying, am I meeting some of these minimum thresholds? I mean, that's your base starting point, but then you got to look at what's happening in that local area or that market.
What's the argument to fully insured versus self-funded? What do those terms mean? A lot of people out there get confused or just simply don't know.
Yeah, sure. That's a great question. And again, I'll relate back to, you know, I've been doing this for 16 years, so not my whole career, but a pretty long time. And when I started in the industry, self-funding was pretty much relegated to large, I won't say jumbo employers, but probably a minimum of 300, 400, 500 plus employees before you looked at self-funding. What really has occurred over the last probably 10 years is the insurance carriers, other carriers have come up with more of these level self-funding products where a smaller employer can take advantage of self-funding. And really all we're doing when we're self-funding is the employer is bearing a little more risk up front, but they've got protections behind the scenes with what's called stop-loss insurance. So you still have an insurance layer to pick up those catastrophic claims, but you're paying more, you know, up front, I'll say, for some of those less expensive claims. And by pulling the insurance carrier out of the mix in that, in some respect, you're carving some, I'll say, of that profit out and trying to retain that. And most of those programs, if there's dollars left over, if you don't spend the amount that's budgeted, that money can come back to the plan as a surplus. So it is a way to combat what we would call fully insured would be the alternative, where you're paying a premium to the insurance company, Highmark Capital, Aetna, United, some of the names we're all familiar with, and if you run poorly, you can expect a huge increase the next year. If you run very well, you can still expect an increase, but they're not going to give you money back that they did not spend on care, essentially. So that's in very simple terms, taking a little more risk under self-funding, but with protections on the back end from any kind of catastrophic claim.
It would seem if you're self-funded, does the employer see the employee's benefits claims? Because that's protected health information,
sure.
And now welcome HIPAA, right?
Sure. Yeah, another great question. And the answer is, you know, it depends. There's so many different self-funded products. So depending on your group size, you'll get very minimal data, no names, no conditions, just dollar amounts for some of our smaller groups that are self-funded. So you'll see the dollars you have set aside to pay claims, and you'll see dollars that were paid out, but very basic information.
See, I thought self-funded plans were only for the larger companies, the Penske's and
sure.
the East Penn's and all that locally. It just surprises me that a smaller company would want to even roll the dice on that.
Yeah, and I think the key there, Bob, is understanding, you know, standalone self-funding, which a large employer like a Penske or a Tower Health would do. So they're really bearing all that risk. They are still buying that protective insurance on the tail end. But the real trend has been what we call level self-funding for small groups, where you are capped. So basically, you know your worst case scenario all in. You can never spend more than the number that is set forth for that 12-month period, essentially. And you're pooling together with other other groups that are in that self-funded pool. So there are some inherent protections, but you're right. Prior to those products existing, you needed to be a really large, kind of credible employer to be able to self-fund on your own, essentially.
What do you think the correct level of employees is now? I know you said back in the day it was 500. Can you get away with less and still be level self-funded?
Sure, yeah. I mean, we've seen groups as little 300, maybe even 200 that are standalone self-funding. But the big challenge is in that stop-loss layer. So if you recall, I brought that layer that picks up that catastrophic claim. Right. If you're a smaller employer, if you have one large claim, you run the risk of that stop-loss carrier, that stopgap insurer coming back and not renewing that policy.
Right.
The advantage to these level self-funded plans is that they can't do that. So there's protections where that stop-loss carrier can't come back and kind of not renew you the following year. But we've seen groups with 300 and 400 employees that were standalone self-funded go back to these level models because they like that budgetability. They know what they're going to pay
right.
every month, and if there's money left over, great. If there's not, they're not being called for more money. Very different model, but again, relatively new that these products have been out there for smaller employers, and they'll go down to five employees with some of these products, and again, you do have protections built in.
Now, is this unique to certain states? How does it work? Does every state's insurance commissioner have a different set of rules for these companies?
Not that I'm aware of. I think it really comes down to the carriers that are interested. So I can speak locally. We have two competing blues here in our market, which not all states do. We have Capital Blue Cross, Highmark Blue Shield. Capital has a product for employers down as low as five employees. That's a kind of a modified self-funding product. Highmark doesn't offer that. They have they're not interested, or to date haven't been interested in really rolling anything out like that. But Aetna and United both have similar products to Capital. So I think it depends on the insurance carrier and you know, the market they're looking to serve.
How about the premium? Does the employer pay the full boat of the premium? Do employees make any contribution to the premium?
Yeah, that's, again, in talking to Ben, that's the tough part. How do you control, you know, that split as these costs rise? And I think typically what we see is most of our groups want to pay as much as they can towards that single premium. So for their actual employee that shows up every day. And we see many groups that will, again, pay 80, 85. I've seen groups that pay 100% of that employee's premium. The challenge we've seen, and it's becoming even more of a challenge every year, is how do you handle those other tiers of coverage? If someone has a spouse or children or a full family on the plan, those premiums get more expensive, and that balancing act of how much additional dollars are they willing to spend for those tiers of coverage. And there's never an easy answer to that. In fact, we have some groups that put in certain rules and regulations that say if your spouse has insurance available to them at their place of employment, they're not even eligible for our plan, and that's very, very common. So that's what I've seen employers trying to do as much as they can for that single employee, the one that's actually showing up every day and working for them, and then doing their best to figure out how much they're going to contribute towards those other tiers.
What do you think the industry standard is for those, you know, the spouse, the children, the dependents?
Sure. I mean, we've seen, you know, for that single coverage, as I mentioned, I want to say the last, and again, I mentioned the Kaiser study, which is probably the biggest in the country, but for larger employers, they'll speak in terms of dollars or percentages, but I think most recently, you know, a single was, you know, being asked to pay upwards of $150 maybe per month towards the benefits. And what we've typically seen is employers will look at that next tier, let's say that family coverage, and they'll still apply maybe that same dollar amount that they did for that single coverage, and then they'll look at the difference and maybe do a 50-50 split. That's not perfect math, but we see a lot of groups attempting to do that, so they'll pick up half of that additional cost
still
for those dependents.
Benefit.
Correct. And again, we've got groups where their premiums are still relatively, as far as benchmarking goes, relatively low. I've got groups that they're, you know, double and triple what these national averages are for premiums, because it depends on the makeup of your group, in some cases your claims history. So that's the one, I'll say, word of caution I give with benchmarking is, you know, it is based on these large employers,
right.
and not one size fits all.
What do you think for some of our smaller employers out there, especially with less than 50 employees, what are they legally obligated to do on the benefits side?
Yeah, great question. Technically speaking, they're, you know, when the Affordable Care Act was passed, groups under 50 were not mandated to offer insurance. In other words, they weren't penalized if they didn't offer it. I would say almost all of our groups of that size still retained coverage. And then the other phenomenon that really, you know, the Affordable Care Act was passed in 2010, but in 2014 was the advent of these age rates for the exact segment that you mentioned, that kind of 2 to 50, 2 to 49 employee segment. For the first time ever in 2014, the insurance carriers had to provide a rate based on the age, and it could not waiver based on gender or health condition. So that was a game changer. In some cases, it was great for groups that had always had high risk and had challenges going through any kind of medical underwriting, which was commonplace before the Affordable Care Act.
Excuse me, you might want to explain medical underwriting to some of these HR, some of these company employees that don't realize what's behind the curtain.
I'd like to forget those days. So when I started in the industry, groups of all sizes, when we would go out and get quotes from all the insurance carriers, they would be what we would consider an illustrative quote. It was not a final quote, not a final rate. And each insurance carrier required employers to hand out medical applications, 20 or 30 medical questions that would have to be completed by every employee on the plan and their dependents. They'd have to add that information in, and they would list everything from the prescriptions that they took to any upcoming procedure, any past health conditions that they had. We would send those back into the insurance companies, and they would then basically set the rate based on those.
Double it.
Yeah.
Correct.
Very. And just in time that it's already too late to renew your old one.
Correct. Those were very painful times. None of the carriers accepted the other carrier's applications, so you were filling out multiple applications. Fast forward to 2014, and what was decided for these small groups is we are now just going to have a rate based on age, period, case closed. So. Yeah. It made our lives a lot easier. The one thing it did, maybe unintentionally, is it kind of penalized healthy groups, right? So there were some groups, even with the minutiae of those medical applications, that would fare very well by filling those out because maybe they had a young, healthy group. Those were the groups that actually saw like 50 and 60% increases in 2014 from these age-rated plans. So it was tough for people to wrap their head around that a young, healthy group was getting a 50% increase from the old system, and a group that had maybe some major health concerns was seeing actually a decrease in their rates. So I think overall the age-rated plans, now that they've been in place since 2014, have been a good thing. I think it's helped groups actually that would otherwise really be penalized. But I will tell you that's really been the advent of those self-funded plans for small groups, is kind of to circumvent maybe a healthier group that can do better, you know, through that process.
Maybe you could walk the audience, people, the HR, the small business managers, especially, and owners. How's the sausage made? it's coming up your September renewal date. It's maybe June or July, and they come to you. You go to them and prompt it. What happens?
So another thing I would say over the last few years, the carriers have done a better job of releasing renewals a little bit earlier. I remember, again, starting in the industry, and you'd be lucky if you saw that renewal 60 days prior to the renewal date, and now we're scrambling, of course. Our job is we go to all the different insurance carriers that are licensed to sell health insurance in this part of Pennsylvania and ask for quotes. So we go to you, the employer, give us a census of your employees, their name, their date of birth, how they're covered. We market that to all the insurance carriers.
Is their job title important to you, to the insurance company?
Not for medical insurance. If we're insuring you for life or disability, that's a whole other topic. Then they're going to look for salary.
Yeah, we're talking about medical. Sorry.
That's kind of the making of the sausage. Is we're taking your demographic information and we're marketing that to all the insurance carriers. And then if the timing is right, I'm hopefully coming back to you as close to 60 days in advance of that renewal with those marketing results. And then our job is to balance coverage, network, drug card with cost and decide, where the best, what the best option is. That in a nutshell is what we do and how it works. And then larger employers that might be self-funded, that's a whole different process. We're not necessarily marketing that in the same manner because they're paying their claims, they're paying for what they use. So. While they still need a network to access services and they still need a drug card, the shopping of that is a little different versus a smaller group that might be looking at all the carriers that, that sell insurance here in PA.
Now, if an employer is looking to keep from passing on those costs to their employees, I mean, you know, obviously inflation, things like that.
Sure.
The cost of insurance, whatever plan you're using, is going up, you know, year over year, and is expected to do so for the next few years. If they're in that mode and they're trying to keep away these costs, you know, on a continuum, what are some of the steps that they can take to mitigate that?
Sure. You know, one of the most common things we would do is change the deductible, right? Not a perfect solution, but basically put more risk on the employer, right, which they don't love, that they're going to be more out of pocket when they use the insurance. But by doing that, the result would be a lower premium, right? Just like any type of insurance, if you're going to pay more out of your pocket, you could expect that fixed premium to be a little bit lower. So for years, again, not a perfect solution, is we would ratchet that deductible up from $500 to $1,000 to $2,000 to $4,000. Some carriers are offering deductibles as high as $9,000 today is about the max that you'll see.
You got $9,000 sitting around somewhere for.
However, what most employers would do is if they would sign up for that type of deductible is they would use maybe an additional mechanism like a health reimbursement arrangement where they would calculate it, say, okay, we're going to sign up for this lower premium with a higher deductible, but we will also reimburse our employees over anything over $1,000, for example. We'll actually reimburse them through a health reimbursement arrangement.
Is that like what used to be, I was familiar with, medical expense reimbursement program?
Same exact
MERPs?
Thing.
That's
yep, same idea, different acronym, but basically the same idea. Yeah. And again, calculated risk, because when you're talking deductible in our world, most of the time, deductible services are going to be a surgery, a hospital stay, imaging, and maybe blood work. So not every employee is going to be going for those services. So you're taking somewhat of a calculated risk in that only a portion of those employees will ever be reimbursed, really any of that deductible, and typically very few are reimbursed the full deductible. So again, not a perfect solution. That's one cost control measure that we've seen. And more recently, we're seeing the insurance carriers offering these tiered networks where if you go, I'll use an example locally, if you go to Penn State, the old St. Joe's, and you're with a certain insurance carrier, they may charge you a lower copay or a lower deductible amount versus if I'm getting that same service at Tower, I'm now in a secondary tier that has a higher deductible and a higher copay, and they might even have a third tier that's out of network where they're actually excluding certain facilities or providers because they are trying to focus on the lower cost providers. So we have seen some of that.
What happens when an employee like lives in York and they don't have WellSpan?
It's a great question.
Where do they go? 35 miles to Lancaster?
and that's a great question. That's again part of our job is to explain that right to the company is if you're going to go to one of these plans, you might have a WellSpan that's carved out, or you might have a Tower Health that's carved out of that network. And you know, can we do that with the employee base based on where people live and access care? And sometimes that answer is no, and you can't, because you're correct. The alternative is if WellSpan is out and Lancaster General is in, then that person may have to drive for a service to be considered in network, or they'll be out of network.
Now,
not
know,
ideal.
I'm not a lawyer. I'm not practicing law by any stretch. But would the employer be able to go to that employee and say, listen, everybody else is paying up to the deductible of $2,000, and when your out of pocket hits that, I'll cover anything over that because we've chosen a plan that has a hospital up in Mongolia and. I don't know. Is that discrimination? I mean, are they allowed to do that? And
I mean, you know, most things we're privy to, there's things we aren't, so who knows if that, I'm sure that has occurred, maybe a side deal like that. Technically speaking, we like to see things kind of the same across the board, right? What I'm doing for one employee, I'm kind of doing for all
right.
employees, and you would, Ben, know better than I would as far as some of those rules and regulations. But that, our rule of thumb is we really want to try to do the same thing. Payroll deductions, we'd like to see those the same. We'd like to not see the owners having it all paid for and the employees only having 80% of it paid for. But as far as something like that where a network is split and someone doesn't have access, I haven't necessarily heard or seen that conversation occur. It doesn't mean it hasn't. Again, from a legal perspective, unless someone called that employer out, I'm not sure what the liability would be. But I would say it's not a great idea. We would usually advise against that.
Right. be one of your benefit goals to have in mind, the serviceability for our employees.
And you're opening up that person having to, what, bring a bill in and say, well, I was out of network, here's the service I had, you know, I need $1,000. Now you're, the employer's becoming, making those decisions on should they cover that.
Yeah. And it's not always the insurance company that's preferring one hospital over another. Many times it's the hospital that can't get any contract concessions from the insurance company, so they drop the insurance company.
Absolutely.
Which doesn't help the employers who chose that insurance for their workers. Have you seen that? I mean, is that devastating or just business?
Yeah, I know before my time, not long before my time in the industry, we had a major insurer here, that national insurer, that dropped at the time Reading Hospital before they were Tower Health, and really did it kind of in the middle of a year, so there was very little notice, and people were all of a sudden
obligated to honor that.
Again, but yeah, before my time, my understanding was no. But we have recently, actually, in the last year, I have seen not hospital systems dropping out, but we have seen some independent. So you might have a practice like a urology practice or digestive disease type of practice that might still be on their own, not owned by the hospital system, that's negotiating separately with Aetna or United or Blue Cross or Blue Shield. We have seen some of that happen. Typically in the 11th hour, they strike a deal. But we've actually had a couple of occurrences this year where that didn't happen, and some of these practices that aren't hospital-owned have dropped out of network. It's rare that the hospitals now own so many of these primary care physicians, pediatric physicians. They might own cardiology, they might own OBGYN. So if the hospital system owns those practices, chances are less of a risk of that happening. But yeah, any independent practice, orthopedic, urology, things like that, that might still be independent or negotiating contracts separately. And we have seen some of that in the last year or two.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think is the role of wellness programs for reducing some of these costs as well, especially larger employers who may be on that self-funded program?
Yeah, and again, just using kind of my time in the industry, I remember, you know, the first few years that I was in the industry, all these wellness companies would call on us and you know, ask us to pitch wellness to our groups, and you know, there's a return on investment, an ROI that we can put on paper. And what you realize pretty quickly, it was almost impossible to do that, to show them an ROI. For every dollar I spend on wellness, I'm going to reduce my claims by $2. It's just really, at the end of the day, it's tough to pinpoint that. So I think what we've seen is the employers that we know that embrace it, or employers that just they think it's the right thing to do, right? They might be paternalistic in their view of their employees, and they know it's the right thing. They want everyone to be healthy, and they'll put that in place and spend the money with no guarantee that dollars are going to come back. So I've opinions, kind of strong opinions on wellness. I think it's a great thing to do. I'd love to see every employer do it, but realistically, when you're talking the cost of health insurance, to add another layer of cost to try and get people to eat better or not smoke or lose weight, you're only going to do so much. And then it comes back to the carrot or the stick approach. Am I penalizing people that don't participate by raising their insurance premium? Their cost share is one of the common things that we'll see.
Right, yeah.
But if you understand wellness programs, you have to provide a alternative to people. So if maybe they can't lose weight because of a condition, so you can't necessarily have the same criteria for every person.
I've seen articles in SHRM magazines. There's one recently about the employers with wellness plans. Because of COVID, it brought wellness and healthy lifestyles and masking. It brought all that to the fore.
Sure.
And there's still some issues out there about quantification. But if nothing else, it's a good culture-building tool for them as well. If you look on the spectrum of, it might not be very important, but it sure is highly satisfying spectrum.
I think wellness programs are one of those things that you shouldn't think of in the benefits realm, like you said, employee culture. But the more you buy into that as part of your employee culture, the more likely you are to see some of the benefits down the road on your insurance costs.
Especially if you're big enough to have a little weight room or
correct
the exercise machines or something, or a subsidy like for silver sneakers.
Especially, sure, a big one that's helped a lot of employers is bringing in dentists, bringing in some of the primary care providers, like a mobile site unit. Hey, we've got you here. especially more of those professions that are more unlikely to go and seek primary care, bringing it on site and making it as easy as possible as part of that wellness program, while maybe not directly correlated, is going to have some other benefits because you get that primary care up front and not having to lag behind like we've seen from COVID.
Yeah, I was going to wonder if we've looked at dental insurance already, and it looked like you almost pay more in premium than employees are using it for the benefit. I mean, how come that's inverted?
Yeah, again, dental is one of the, dental insurance, vision insurance, those are coverages that not all employers or employees necessarily believe in. To your point, am I spending more in the premium than the value of the benefit? We can typically look at a premium and on a pre-tax basis, right? Because you can pay these premiums pre-tax, that if someone is getting their two cleanings a year,
And that's an HSA at that point, pre-tax contributions?
Well, it's part of section, like a POP document, section 125. So it's part of the cafeteria plan that you're allowed to take that on a pre-tax basis. But and FSA falls under that same categorization. But we're talking just like
flexible
a pre-tax.
Flex spending account.
Flex spending accounts, yeah. Correct.
Acronyms
all of that.
Acronyms confuse some of the people.
Correct.
In TV
I
land.
Forget that sometimes. Yeah. But for dental insurance specifically, if an employer offers it, usually when I have my meetings, I'll explain, hey, if you're, it's coming out pre-tax, if you're getting your two cleanings a year and your dentist would charge, $100 for that cleaning without insurance, you try to get you to a break even. But if you've got family coverage and, not everyone's going, not everyone's getting those cleanings, you could argue that it's not worth the money. And we see employers offering things like that, dental and vision, often on a voluntary basis. So the employer's not necessarily paying that. They're leaving it up to the employee, and some believe in it and some don't. And, we see that trend growing significantly is voluntary type benefits. Let people pick the benefits they want versus being, told here's the benefits you're getting.
Do you ever go to the employer with, they're going to ask you, how can I cut my premium increases constantly, year after year? What can I do to control my cost?
Yeah.
And still want to offer the benefit? I mean, what do you tell them?
Yeah, it can be a tough discussion. And again, so much of what we do is based on group size, right? The amount of employees, what we can and can't offer. And then for a larger group, how are their claims data? Are they a healthy group? Are they not a very healthy group?
And you
group?
Can see that, but they can't.
And there's certain information they can see and certain information they can't see. But at the end of the day, if you've got a group that's maybe not a large group, they're not, and they've got a population that's maybe unhealthy or even a few people that are driving that cost up, there's not always a simple answer to that. That's just the fact of the matter. And that's where we start looking at other insurance carriers, maybe higher deductibles, maybe those split networks, which again, not a perfect solution, but you have to make some hard choices when you see those premiums getting kind of ratcheted up year over year.
How popular are short and long-term disability programs? And I saw something in one of the SHRM journals, an article on unlimited PTO. I mean, how could you do that?
Yes, I've read about that. I've experienced it actually as well. So I would, I don't know exactly from a percentage basis, I would guess probably half of our groups offer an employer paid, like short-term, long-term disability, life insurance. The other half probably do it on a voluntary basis. But we do see that, again, depending on the industry, depending on the client, if they're gonna pay for that. We have other groups that maybe won't do a short-term disability. They'll do a salary continuation. If someone goes out maybe for a shorter period, and they might just purchase long-term disability, which kicks in after 90 days of not being being on the job, and that can pay you all the way up till Social Security normal retirement age. So it's a bit of a mixed bag on what we see from our groups in offering those types of benefits.
In the time we have left, and we do have a good 15 or minutes or so, but look into your crystal ball. What's the next 10, 12 months look like for health insurance?
Yeah, I mean, we're starting, our biggest renewal month is January 1st. Very kind of cyclical in our industry. So we're kind of in the thick of it. We work many months in advance. We're starting to see some of those renewals. Again, for our self-funded groups, they're doing much, much better than those in that fully insured market. And but you have to understand too is medical trend cost, right? So we talk about it all the time. Even if you're a healthy group, If you have the exact same services next year that you had this year, so in 2024, if I have the same amount of MRIs, the same amount of CAT scans, the same amount of people taking an expensive specialty drug, how much does that go up year over year? And depending on who you listen to, what you read, you'll see trend being anywhere 7, 8, 9%. So you could argue even a healthy group could expect to see a 7, 8, 9% increase. Someone better than that could get less than trend. Someone worse than that could see that 20 or 30% increase.
We see these large national health insurance companies reporting billions of dollars of revenue every quarter. You know, that's going somewhere.
Sure. Sure. Well, and
they're not paying tax on it.
No, they're not. And you may or may not remember a piece of the Affordable Care Act is that the government did put a little bit of a stopgap gap mechanism in there called the medical loss ratio, MLR,
right,
where insurers do need to report back on how much of the premium use gave them they spent on care. And basically, they need to be spending, depending on group size, either 80 cents or 85 cents of the dollar that you paid them on care, and if they don't, they have to cut you a check. And the insurance carrier has to actually pay that employer back
to the employer.
Correct. Yeah. What some people don't understand is, again, they aggregate that data. So it's not, they're looking at their block as a whole if they've met that threshold. Any one given employer, that insurance carrier may not have spent 80 cents on the dollar for care. They may have only spent 50 or 60 cents. So,
for your specific
correct,
pool.
For your specific pool, right. So a lot of these rules and regs that are out there, they're kind of aggregating their blocks of business together when they're kind of reporting on that. But yeah, I wish I could, like you said, the crystal ball. We certainly don't see it go down. The only thing that we've seen since the advent of these self-funded products, we have definitely seen more control over those increases. They've been a lot smaller than they were before those products existed.
Yeah, I think in certain insurance products, they coalesce into risk retention groups. Does Pennsylvania have risk retention groups for, like, employees fewer than 50 or something like that? Is that possible to aggregate those kinds of employers into risk retention groups?
So there was some talk, there was a lot of the association plans you might be referencing. That was a term that crept up in the last couple of years where smaller groups could kind of come together as one. I don't know if that's what you're referencing, but back in the day, the PA Chamber used to have their own association product. So it was through Highmark, and it was different plan designs than what you could get if you were not in the association, and that risk pool was controlled
right,
a little more tightly.
It's all about spreading the risk around one way
or
another.
And really, actually, with the Affordable Care Act, you saw those disband. It was kind of a nuance of the law. We saw all of those pretty much go away. There was a bar association program for lawyers. There was the PCI, which was the chamber program. There was something out there for dental orthodontic providers. But we really saw a lot of that go by the wayside. And in the last few years, there's been discussions about bringing some kind of association plans back. But to date, it really hasn't gained any traction. So we're waiting to see if that that changes. We're all for obviously more options, more competition. Those are all good things. And I will say, in our neck of the woods in PA, we have more options than many states do as far as insurers that are kind of competing for business here. You'll go to some states that are dominated by two carriers at best. And while the Blues are still kind of the most dominant here, Capital and Highmark, we have Aetna, we have United, we have Cigna, we have Geisinger, which is a more regional carrier. We have UPMC, based out of Pittsburgh. They're only now marketing to groups with 50 or more employees, but there was a time when they were in the small group market and very competitive. So that's a good thing. We're not seeing carriers kind of drop out. We're actually seeing more in the market. So we're optimistic that can help.
Ben, I think that you said we were talking earlier, you've seen the employee benefit statement that's like, this is the hidden paycheck, look at how
right.
good we are.
I think if it's done in a really, good manner as far as the rollout, I mean, the worst thing is just a piece of paper or an email saying, hey, this is what you got for the year, without a good communication strategy or a good explanation. That creates more questions. But if you have a good plan in place where you say, hey, we're communicating to you, you show each bucket, hey, this is going to this place, this is going to that, rather than just an overall figure, it helps. And also, I think getting kind of, you know, employee buyback with some forums and saying, you know, what has been your experience with the benefits that we've offered, that's kind of another way to help inform your goals for the next year. I was actually even going to say that, you know, to kind of clean up the mess or, you know, clean up things, that maybe there's a trend towards the health reimbursement account. You know, basically say, hey, especially for smaller employers who are wanting to offer that, you know, I'm just going to give a flat fee out there and let you have more choice as the employee. Then, you know, you don't have to do those total benefits amount statements as much. You'll say, this is the amount you get. Do with it as you want for your own health care needs. Yeah. Make it a little bit easier. But, you know, again, if you do coordinate it, a lot of employees don't even realize how much is going into benefits. I mean, some of the statements that I've worked up, it's people are like, I never knew that it was costing that much. They think of the price that they're paying each paycheck. Oh, I pay $18 or I pay $150 for this. You know, that's my health care costs. Not realizing that the employer is paying a significant portion.
Yeah, I think it was a few years ago, there was a trend on employers giving retirees an amount of money that says, we're terminating the retiree coverage, here's an amount of money, go fend. And it seemed to have died off almost as soon as it came up.
Yeah, I mean, you have to be cautious. You know, if you have someone that's able to go on Medicare, let's say age 65, so it's not due to a disability, it's just age, turning 65 now Medicare eligible, if that person is still staying actively at work, there are rules that you really, really can't incentivize them, that you need to offer them that same group benefit, because they can stay on your group plan, they'll pick up their, you know, Part A Medicare, and then they'll use your group plan and your drug plan to fill in the gaps of the pieces that Medicare, you know, doesn't cover. Yeah. Again, I will tell you, not being naive, is that I'm sure we have groups that behind the scenes, some of that is occurring, especially for an age-rated group where that 65-year-old is probably costing you upwards of $1,600 or $1,700 a month in premium, whereas they could go and get their Part A, Part B in a supplement for much less. So I know that there's probably employers having those discussions maybe offline, but letter of the law is you're really not supposed to be incentivizing. There is one piece that the IRS came out with, something called an ICRA, another acronym. It's like an individual HRA, where if you're a big enough employer, you could carve out that your Medicare eligible employees wouldn't be on this group plan, but you can legally give them money on a tax favored basis to buy that Medicare product, whatever dollar amount you determine. But without something like that in place, technically you're not supposed to incentivize people to get off the plan. Sometimes they automatically do. If the employer charges a lot towards that premium, they're going to come to their own conclusion and say it's better for me to take those Medicare supplements versus my group plan. So that's a lot of discussion around that every year with our groups, because of how expensive some of those premiums can get for those, especially for the age-rated groups.
Now, for employers in this area, I don't know how big PK Benefits is footprint-wise, but do you also advise employers on making benefits matrices, like all the benefits and who it applies to and whatever, something of that nature? Or you're more in the health insurance and insurance end of it, as opposed to all the other kinds of benefits that are out there?
I understand the question. Yeah, I mean, we're mostly, you know, health, life, disability, dental, vision, flex spending account, health savings account, all the things that revolve around that. So that's pretty much what we do. Our footprint is here, Schuylkill County, up into the Scranton-Wilkes-Barre area. But and then all the compliance pieces that revolve around everything I just kind of mentioned that we sell. That's kind of where, that's what we do. As far as any other fringe benefits, other types of benefits that would exist, we leave that to folks in different industries, essentially, to provide that. And we have partnerships if our groups are looking you know, for help in any of those other types of coverages, we obviously can make recommendations.
Do you see anything there? There was, for a while, there was a benefit circulating and being offered. I don't know if it's legal insurance.
Like a prepaid legal?
They have a prepaid legal plan. They have these huge law firms that you can call 24/7 and you get two calls or two consultations and traffic ticket.
The booths for a while, you know, for a few years. They would be at, like, the open enrollment little.
I remember seeing them at the chamber events, too, prepaid legal plans. Yeah, it seemed like a decent deal. you're eventually going to have a problem with mechanic, an accountant, maybe a landlord. I mean, eventually you're gonna have a
some sort of civil litigation. Yeah.
And of course, it's all civil litigation.
Yeah, and to Ben's point, I remember getting kind of called on by groups that were doing that in the past. What we've actually seen is some of the our ancillary carriers is the term that we'll use. So the groups that sell life and disability, short term, long term, some are starting to package that actually along with those products. So they'll package something like that. They'll package an employee assistance program, which you're probably familiar with, like an EAP. So you can buy that separately. But a lot of carriers, if you have short and long term disability, kind of will include that. So I've seen some of the prepaid legal as part of a broader offering in ancillary benefits versus standalone.
I think some of the low cost, fringe benefits that you can offer, some of this legal advice for other folks, it might be, gym membership,
sure,
go along with the wellness stuff, or we'll pay for your commuter. Any of these that you can do that are low cost but high impact to your employee is something that's, a win-win situation for most companies, again, given their size.
Do you handle workers' comp at all?
We personally do not out of our office. Again, that's where our partnerships of someone. But yeah, we don't do that. The only, our involvement there might be a coordination of benefits if someone's injured, on the job. We may get involved to make sure that that's a coordination of who's paying that is happening properly, but we're not in the we don't market that coverage.
Okay, yeah, this is such a wide field, and I know I wish we had couple more hours to delve into it. I have notes everywhere now. Do this, check on this tomorrow, kind of a thing.
The one other thing I'll quickly mention, because we talked about like the prepaid legal, we've talked about wellness, is the one thing that I do and that consultants do is to try to bring all the benefits that the insurance carrier offers and that's built in. I think I won't say it's upsetting to me, but it's unfortunate, is there's so much that is actually offered by the carriers that's right, built into your plan, and we do our best to communicate that at open enrollment and provide digital communication, physical, still handouts, people still like those, and point them towards that gym membership is heavily discounted or potentially free, depending on who the carrier is, or they've got their own wellness program, like a Capital Blue Cross, that if you do these four things, they're going to send you $100 on a debit card. So there are a lot of things that the carriers are doing, and it's really imperative that that they understand, employees understand what's afforded to them, and hopefully take advantage of those.
I know there's one thing I saw used already, saw an article on it too, and it piqued my interest again. But for the company to do we do satisfaction surveys,
sure,
and things like that, attitude surveys, but they list all the benefits from 1 to 25, and they ask the employees to rank them in order of importance. And the next day, they ask them to rank them in order of satisfaction.
Interesting.
And then you do something called a statistical ledger domain called conjoint analysis, and you're able to identify the best mix for the, because they don't know the
cost
of anything.
Right, we'll get you the best bang for the buck.
And so it just struck me that what you were saying, with everything's packaged in these group health insurance plans anymore, it's almost like trying to buy a stripped down Toyota. You can't do it.
Right.
They have all the bells and whistles whether you want them or not.
Sure, sure.
It just seems like, and I didn't realize it until you just articulated that. So,
well, I think it brings us almost full circle back to the talking of self-funding, which we try to loosely define, is that's where you can carve those things out, right? So that's still an employer's best opportunity to provide a quality program, but still cover the things that they think are important, or maybe they've surveyed the employees to see what's important. Unfortunately, depending on your group size, you are getting kind of an off-the-shelf prepackaged plan in many cases.
So you get all these quotes, all these tentative quotes from all these insurance companies, and it must be, we'll say maybe a dozen, you get them in. How do you sift through that to know what two or three or four maybe to offer to the employer?
Yeah, sure.
How do you percolate, let that percolate to the top?
Well, I'm a big, process of elimination fan, so while we'll go to every carrier to make sure we're not missing an opportunity, my job is to quickly say, okay, we went to six different carriers, four of them make no sense based on the pricing and the offering, so we're not even, we can talk about them briefly, but that's not the recommendation. typically it will come down to two, maybe three carriers at most, at least in the fully insured world, that may be competitive. And then at that point, it's our job to break down the plan design, the drug formulary. So are we talking apples to apples, or are we talking apples and oranges? And really get a little more granular as far as what each plan offers, networks, so on and so forth. And then at that point, what's the tolerance of the employer to offer a plan that maybe doesn't have as broad of a network, but is the lowest cost for those employees.
Right.
But it's done via spreadsheet and summaries. That's another big piece of what we do is executive summaries to go along with that 20
really,
pages of spreadsheet.
It really is hard because a lot of employees, this is not their world.
No,
not
at all.
It's the HR world, it's your world.
Sure.
And things, so we get it, but...
Even in the HR world, it's often segmented off. Like, hey, it's that particular office.
Sure.
I focus on compensation, benefits generally, but a lot of times it's segmented.
In the 2 minutes we have left, I wanted to first thank both of you, Andrew Schreffler, Executive VP of Benefits for PK Benefits.
It's a mouthful.
And give my best to Mark.
I will.
And Jessica, too.
Yes.
She and I were on the small business committee for many years.
Okay.
Back when.
Yeah.
And Benjamin Lewis, compensation analyst for Chester County. Thank you for coming back, and we hope you're going to see more of you.
We really will.
Do hope we're going to see more of you.
We will.
And I certainly want to thank the people behind the engineering booth there. We have Rachel, John, Xavier, and Joan. And thank you so much for all that you're doing for us to bring this. And the people at BCTV here, empowering people, engaging communities through media is their tagline. Nothing could be closer to the truth. We certainly want to thank our underwriter, Herbine HR Consulting, their full-service professional human resource consulting firm. And they're out there in Morgantown Road, 2433, Morgantown Road, Suite 100. And you can reach them at 610-779-3870 if you have any questions or concerns about your HR responsibilities. And last but not least, we want to recognize the Berks County chapter of from the Society of Human Resource Management. And if you're interested in seeing who we are and what we're doing, you can reach out to our administrative director through our website, www.berkspa.shrm.org. And these things will be up at the end of at the bottom of the program here that you can avail yourself of those resources. Our next program will air the second Tuesday of November, and we'll record it probably the day before, so we ensure timely information. And Andrew, we'll be thinking about you with all those 16,000.
Thank you.
Open enrollment season.
It's a fun
it's hard.
Season for
always
us.
A
yeah.
Fun part.
Absolutely.
So with that, we're going to close out another. This is our 104th program into our 17th year, and. We'll see you back in November. Thank you. Goodbye.
Some of the great things about Berks Sherm chapter is that it is a very active and robust group of individuals that work and live in this community. And we meet once a month to discuss subjects or issues and that we need to discuss to be a better place for work. But also we meet a lot of great individuals that help. We help each other when we have any questions or any issues to discuss. So it's very good to have that supportive group and to work together and to meet together to support each other with anything that we may need.
Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Herbine HR Consulting.